this series called The Seven Letters, based on early writings in the book of Revelation, a book that can be scary, as we've mentioned, a book that can kind of send chills and give us a little bit of fear, and we want to avoid that last book of the New Testament. But on this island of Patmos, the disciple John was given a personal visitation and a personal revelation from Jesus himself, of Jesus himself. The entire book is to allow us to see Christ in a new, in a fresh, in a glorified way. And every week as we've gone through this, I start with this verse in the very first chapter of the book of Revelation, the third verse. Now, this is one of God's promises. God has made a promise to us. And through over 2,000 years of people reading the book of Revelation, this promise has held true. It says, God blesses the one who reads the words of this prophecy to the church. One more time, by his grace and mercy and blessing, that is my privilege tonight. And he blesses all who listen to its message and obey what it says, for the time is near. Look at it this way tonight. God blesses the one who listens. That's what you will do through the next, say, 30 minutes. That's the listening part. The obeying part that completes the promise of his blessing, of his favor, that happens when you leave this place. That we might call your homework. As we pay attention, as we stay sensitive to the Holy Spirit tonight, as each of us as individuals say, Lord, just talk to me in this. Just speak my name in this. As we do this and leave this place and allow the Holy Spirit to bring it up again through the week, that carries with it our part, the listening and the obeying. And then God has promised to give his favor, known as his blessing. And we first started this series 4 weeks ago. I was saying how the thought of letters and letter writing, that's really a dying art, isn't it? There's not a whole lot of letter writing going on these days. I must say, I appreciate through the month of Pastor Appreciation, many of you that actually took time to write cards and notes to Debbie and I and give those to us. I appreciate that. It represents time. Somebody took the time to sit down and collect their thoughts and still their hearts and write something. That means the world to us. Thank you so much for that. And I grew up with the absolute quintessential letter writer and note writer, my dad, Pop. Is a note writer from way back. He's one of those guys that he is just so thoughtful to people that he encounters and of course to his family members. I left home, a middle child of five. I left home when I was 20 years old. I left, I found the love of my life, and I said goodbye to mom and pop, and we made on our way our journey together. But I'm telling you, every single year, whether near or far, Pop never failed to send me a birthday card. In that birthday card would always be a gift. And in that birthday card, to this day, this year, there would always be a scripture reference. He'd put a Bible verse. He wouldn't write it out. He'd just give me the reference. And that was his way of saying, here is the word of God from your father to you. I appreciated that. Well, several years ago, when we lived in Florida, far away, Pop sent me that annual card on my birthday, and I got it. It was in July 18. If you want to take notes and remember for next year, that would be fine. But it came around July. I got the card, and I go into the living room, and Debbie was there, and Amanda was just a little peanut. She's scurrying around on the floor, and I sat down in our living room, and I opened up the card, and I watched the blessing fall out, and I picked up the blessing before Debbie could and put it in my pocket. And then I looked and I saw the scripture verse in Pop's handwriting, Psalm 27, verses 13 and 14. I'm like, I'm going to read that right now out loud. This is a direct message from my father to me on my birthday. So I grabbed the Bible. This was in the old days when we didn't have the app. There was no cell phones and dinosaurs ruled the earth. It was way long time ago. And I grabbed the actual Bible and I brought it. I sat down, true story, and I opened up to Psalm 27, 13, and 14, and I couldn't wait. I read it out loud spontaneously to Debbie and Amanda, and here's the words that I read. This is the wicked man's portion from God, the heritage the ruthless receive from the Almighty. Though his children are many, they are destined for the sword, and his offspring will never have enough food. I'm not kidding. There was silence in the room. I'm like, Deb, I must have really made Pop upset. He's pronounced a curse on me. What is going on? This is the worst birthday ever. And she goes to me, give me that Bible. And she grabbed it and she said, you knucklehead, you're reading Job 27, not Psalm 27. I was only off by one book, but she was right again. And she turns to the correct reference and she reads these words. Yet I am confident that I will see the Lord's goodness while I'm here in the land of the living. Be brave and courageous. Wait patiently for the Lord. That's more like it. I like that. I like that. But he had sent a message and I missed it. I was just a little bit off and it wasn't even close to hitting the mark. Now tonight, and really through this whole series of letters that Jesus himself is dictating to John and sending to the church, Jesus has an intended message, not only 2,000 plus years ago, but tonight, on this November Saturday, in the Haven Church in Burlington, New Jersey. Listen, we are going to open up a letter from Jesus, and he has an intended message for each one of us. And he said he'd bless us and give us his favor if we pay attention, if we listen. Let's do that tonight. Again, John is writing from the island of Patmos. John is writing to these seven churches that were really there in a place that we now know as modern-day Turkey. Week one, we were in Ephesus. We went north to Smyrna. We went north last week again to Pergamum. Now we take a turn to the south. And tonight we are going to read the fourth letter to a church in a city called Thyatira. Now, as I like to do each week, I want to give you some of the historic background so you understand a little bit more about this actual place where the church was, where this letter was sent. This was the smallest and least significant of the seven cities. Thyatira was famous for the manufacture of purple dye. Any Minnesota Viking fans in the house tonight? That's good. Yeah, but they like purple. They wear purple. Purple came from Thyatira. As a matter of fact, there were numerous references in various historic writings that this was a real manufacturing city of cloth. This was the center of business and trade, and it's a city we might refer to as a blue-collar city. Some of the others we've studied were very highbrow. They were very, very much into knowledge and philosophy. This one was what we'd call a blue-collar town. Lydia, from the book of Acts, chapter 16, verses 14 and 15, she was from Thyatira. This city was known as the center of many guilds or trade societies. Think of them as our unions, our trade unions. This city had them, only they were more than just a place to find work or pay dues. These unions, these trade societies, required their members to participate in worship to idols, often involving sexual immorality. This would make it very difficult for the believer to remain morally pure in an immoral, in adulterous culture. If you did not fall in line and do what they asked, you could not provide for your family. Imagine the pressure on those who are followers of Jesus Christ. And once again this week, I want to remind you without a doubt that this church in Thyatira was filled with people just like you and me. So Jesus has something to say, and I want to walk through these verses found in Revelation. We're going to go chapter 2, and we're going to start with verse 18, I'm going to read again tonight from what's known as the Passion Translation. It is a paraphrase that will make this particular dialogue a little bit easier to understand, and then we will dissect it as we go. Jesus said to John, write the following to the messenger of the congregation in Thyatira. For these are the words of the Son of God. Now, this is the only letter Jesus introduces himself this way. Whose eyes are blazing fire, whose feet are like burnished brass. Jesus is saying in his introduction, basically, here's what he's saying. My eyes are going to pierce through everything. I'm going to discern tonight. I'm going to cut through all the fake and the veneer. I'm going right to the heart tonight. That's what he means by that. And he says, my feet are like burnished brass, which has its inference in judgment. So he's kind of laying it out that this could be a bumpy ride in this letter. Very next verse, 19. I know all that you've done for me. Your love and faith. Your ministry and steadfast perseverance. In fact, Jesus says, you now excel in these virtues even more than at first. What virtues? Love, faith, ministry, perseverance. Jesus is saying to that church, you had those gifts in the beginning, you had that fruit in the beginning, but you actually have more now. You have actually grown deeper. And he continues the letter with a three-letter word. We're about to go somewhere else. Verse 20, he says, but I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, and is seducing my loving servants. She is teaching that it's permissible to indulge in sexual immorality and eat food sacrificed to idols. I'll expound on this in a minute. He goes on to say, I've waited for her to repent from her vile immorality, but she refuses to do so. Now, Jesus says, I will lay her low with terrible distress along with all her adulterous partners if they do not repent. Remember, we talked about repent in detail a couple of weeks ago. And I will strike down her followers with deadly plague. Then all the congregations will realize that I am the one who thoroughly searches the most secret thought and innermost being. That's those eyes he talked about earlier. And I will give to each one what their work deserves. Let me expound a little on this. The Jezebel he's referring to is not actually the name of this individual. Jezebel refers to an actual character, a queen, a king's wife in the Old Testament. When it's referred to throughout Scripture, especially in the New Testament, it deals more with a symbolic seducing spirit. So this church had allowed somebody to come in. They had love, they had faith, they were doing a good thing. They allow somebody to come in, a woman who was in a place of authority, and she began to speak things that were contrary to God's way and God's law with a seducing way. And basically what she was saying is that you can have, that through tolerance and compromise, God will allow your sin and there'll be no reprisals. There's no punishment. You can live however you want. Indulge in however you want. They allowed this person with a place and a voice of authority to come in. But you, even in that, you see Jesus and his mercy, because he says, listen, if they'll repent, if they'll turn around, I'm not going to have to bring judgment. But if they don't, I have to come. And I have to correct the error that's come in. Remember last week, we spent a long time about diluting the truth. That's what happened here in a more extreme and maybe more a public way. A singular voice that had led this congregation, many of them, astray. And Jesus says the word but again, turns it back in the other direction. He says, but to the rest of you. In other words, everyone had not followed this seducing voice. The rest of you in Thyatira who don't adhere to the teaching of Jezebel and may not have been initiated into deep satanic secrets, I'm telling you, this thing got heavy. Jesus says, I say to you, without laying upon you any other burden, in other words, you can handle this, cling tightly to all that you have until I appear. He is telling those who have been faithful, stay faithful. I'm coming. I'm going to help. Stay faithful. Hang on to the truth. We talked about the truth at length last week. And then he concludes with these words in the last few verses. To everyone who is victorious and continues to do my work to the very end, I will give you authority over the nations to shepherd them with a royal scepter. And the rebellious will be shattered like clay pots. Now, think about it for a moment. If you're, say, a factory worker, which is an analogy of the type of blue-collar work they would have had there, you would have worked in a big line. You would have been just an insignificant number. And Jesus is saying, if you hold on, I'm going to give you authority. You're not just going to be somebody in the way back of the line that's just a number punching the clock, as it were. But Jesus said, there is reward coming. And oh, by the way, you who have been overlooked and insignificant in my world, in my reward, you are going to actually have authority. He said, hang on, it'll be worth it. And then he says, even also, you'll receive authority from the presence of my Father. I will give you the morning star to the one who experiences victory. He says, so the one whose heart is open, let him listen carefully to what the Spirit is presently saying to all the churches. What's this morning star business? The morning star refers basically to Jesus Christ. What he is saying to these who are in that long line of just people that nobody ever noticed is, if you stay faithful, you're going to have direct access to the boss man. You're not going to be way in the back of the line. It speaks of intimacy. I love again the fact that Jesus knew this culture intimately. He knew what would inspire them. He knew what would connect with them. And he goes right there and says, there's a lot of mess that's gotten in, but if you'll deal with it, oh, the rewards are going to be amazing. Now, I got to admit, when I first read this letter and read it a couple of times, my first thought was, man, Jesus is angry. Jesus sounds really upset. This one has a little more of an edge than the last few we read, and it just kind of struck me, and I was struck by this question. Does God get angry? Isn't God love? Isn't he goodness? We sang about it. You are good. Isn't he love and goodness and rainbows and just all those wonderful things, the metaphors? Isn't that who God is? Absolutely, that's who God is. And some of you, depending on how you were raised, you actually may believe that God is always angry. I've counseled people like that over the years. They've been given a twisted form of truth. And they've come to believe that if God even notices them, he's probably mad at them, and he's definitely disappointed. And then there are others who maybe have come from another extreme that's illustrated by this Jesus Buddy statue. This is a real statue that's actually located 1 hour from where I'm right now standing in Red Bank, New Jersey. The symbolism of this is Jesus is saying, dude, I'm cool, you're cool, everything's cool, don't sweat it, no problem. Well, somewhere in the middle is where God really is. Let me talk to you about the tone of this letter and the object of Jesus, what you might interpret as anger. Sin is what gets God angry. Now, I'm going to teach a little bit for the next few minutes, maybe a little different way. But here's what I want to encourage you. I'm going to teach the truth of God's word, and God has promised that the truth will not bind us and depress us, but it will set us free. So I'm believing tonight that your hearts are not going to be heavy when you leave. As we go through this, you're going to be liberated. Somebody's going to be freer than you've been in a long time tonight. Sin. Why does God hate sin? Sin separates us from God. God is holy. God is righteous. There is no vile in him. There is nothing sinful about his nature. Sin left unchecked will send a person to an eternity apart from God in a place of torment. That is not God's original plan. That is not God's design. Sin, scripture says, has pleasure for a season. It's a good time. But ultimately, the wages or the payoff is spiritual and sometimes physical death. That is the truth of God's word. God hates sin because sin is a captor. Sin makes us slaves. Sin is a heavy burden we were not meant to carry. It is darkness. And understand, God did not create sin. God created man and gave us a free will, and we gravitated toward that which put distance between us and God. The word sin comes from an ancient Greek word we find mostly in the New Testament. And it basically means failure, being in error, or the one that gives the best visual analogy is sin is missing the mark. Picture that bullseye as being God's perfection and God's perfect will. And picture all those arrows, all our attempts, and we don't even get close to the bullseye. That's us in this journey. Romans 3:23 makes it very clear that all, every one of us have sinned and continually fall short of God's glory. You say, wait a minute, that sounds hopeless. Sin separates us from God. But Jesus Christ is the one that bridged that separation. That's the reason Jesus had to come shed his blood. That's the reason he had to endure the cross and the shame. That's the reason he went through the agony. And all that he did was to bridge that gap between our failure, our inability to please a God who is perfect and holy, and all that stuff that we gravitate to that makes God so upset. Romans 5:8 puts it this way. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Well, we're out there missing the mark. God says, they're not getting it, but I love them. It's my heart to have fellowship with them. It's my heart to have eternity with them. I'm going to make a provision. I'm going to send my only son, and I'm going to sacrifice him so that that gap can be bridged. Oh, I love this verse in 1 John. This is a wonderful promise now. If you're feeling some burden and some guilt of sin, listen, you can let it go in these moments. This is not a place of burden. This is a place of freedom tonight through the anointing and the power of God's Holy Spirit and his word. 1 John 1:9, the same John that wrote these letters wrote this. If we freely admit that we have sinned, and if we confess our sin, he, God, is faithful and just, which means true to his own nature and his promises to forgive our sins, to cleanse us. What's that next word? Continually. From all unrighteousness. So just like Romans says that we continually fall short of the glory of God, John says through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, as we continue to confess, he continually cleanses us. What's unrighteousness? It's our wrongdoing. It's everything not in conformity with his will and his purpose. Let me tell you, I've done some of those things this week. Knowingly or unknowingly, we all fall short continually. But God says, though I hate the act, I have given a provision, and accessing that provision will now allow me to look down upon you in gracious goodness and in mercy. Because although God does get angry at sin, ultimately God is merciful. I'm standing here tonight because of God's mercy. I'm standing here as a trophy of someone that always missed the mark. Someone that squandered years. And yet he said, Paul, if you'll just confess, I'll forgive and I'll cleanse you continually. And so is the testimony of many in this room, because God is merciful. And this church in Thyatira, they had let something bad in, and it began to really, really affect people. It affected their lives, their marriages, everything about them. But God says, I'm still calling out in mercy. If you turn, I will respond in mercy. If you don't know this verse in Lamentations, this is one to either take a picture of tonight, write down, make a note of it, commit to memory, whatever. But this is a portion of scripture that is beautiful. It is poetic and it is absolutely truth. Lamentations 3, verses 20 and 23 through 23. But this I call to mind, or this I remember. Therefore, I have hope. So when I think about this, I have hope. What is he thinking about? That it's because of the Lord's loving kindness we're not all consumed. Because God hates sin. But because of his loving kindness and the blood of Jesus, and the forgiveness and the heart of God, he says, I'm not going to destroy or consume, but rather I'm going to find a way through my tender compassions that never fail to keep that communion, to keep that relationship. And listen, they are new every morning, the writer says. What are new every morning? The tender compassions of God. When you wake up Monday morning, you may not want to go to work, but let me tell you what's greeting you. The tender mercies, the compassions, and the faithfulness of God. God is merciful. Great and beyond measure is God's faithfulness. Great and beyond measure. We all miss the mark. We all come short. But great and beyond measure is God's faithfulness and love. And he says, that's how I'll make a way to bring you to my heart. And I was thinking about, as I was digging through this and considering this church and considering us here at the Haven, I was thinking about these letters and these messages, and we're just a little over halfway through this series, and I thought about something that I wanted to kind of veer off a little bit, but I think it's very important tonight that we understand what was the motivation for Jesus even writing these letters. Think about it. These churches had been started by New Testament apostles and faithful ministers. They had pastors. They had the writings of scripture. They had the gatherings of some of the other writings that were coming together. They had resources. Why would Jesus Christ himself take the time to visit John on that island and send these letters? I believe tonight it's imperative, and it'll be helpful to understand or to look at the motivations of why even tonight we dig in and we read these words of Christ. Let me go to Jeremiah. Start with this. The Lord is speaking here in Jeremiah 31:3, and he says, I have loved you, my people, with an everlasting love. With unfailing love, I have drawn you to myself. The very first motivation for why Jesus sent these letters is because he loves us. He loved that church in Thyatira 2,000 plus years ago, all the way through the centuries up to this very night. It is motivated by the love of Christ. You see, love reaching out, love draws us to that compassionate heart of God the Father. We should sit here and feel condemned for the way we live. But instead, he draws us with an everlasting, unfailing love. And he says, I'll pull you in and I'll love you right to my heart. And through that, you'll find forgiveness. And through that, you'll find the relationship that your heart longs for. Love takes the time to write the letter. Remember, early we talked about that. The expression of writing something down, of taking that time. It's a beautiful, tangible expression of love. Jesus says, I am going to take the time to help my churches because I love them. Look at Proverbs 3, 11 and 12. My child, do not reject the Lord's discipline. And don't be upset when he corrects you. For the Lord corrects those he loves, just as a father corrects a child in whom he delights. So the second motivating factor, I believe, in all this is correction. Any good parent knows that there has to be an element of discipline and correction to being a parent. Now, be honest, we only have one child, but I really hated that whole disciplinarian thing. I hated that. I want to be the good guy. I'll let Debbie be the bad guy. I wanted to be the guy that was fun, and I just didn't want it. But I also know that a child is out of control if you don't set boundaries and if you don't allow those boundaries to be reinforced with some type of discipline. Obviously, we weren't heavy-handed, but there were times, you know, a little pop on the behind or whatever just to get her attention. But I did not like that. And I wonder the heart of God to us as children at this points of correction where maybe he doesn't really want to do it anyway, but he knows that ultimately it's the only way to get our attention and realize if you keep going in that direction, we got trouble over there. I remember one time Amanda was probably about 11, and she was a great kid. She was a really good kid, still is, most of the time. She had crossed the line. She'd crossed the line into an area that was just, no, we can't go there. And it was a pretty big violation. I believe, my best recollection, it had to do with disrespecting her mother. There's no way I was allowing that to happen. And she did something, and it was, you know, in her own way, but she really got disrespectful to Deb. And I was like, okay, time for discipline. I said, Amanda, head up to your room. I'll be up there in a minute. Now, I wasn't torturing her. I was just trying to buy some time to convince Deb to go up and spank her. And I was in the kitchen. I'm like, Deb, you go take care of this. She's like, I'm not taking care of it. You take care of it. She disrespected me. Now you go take care of it. Okay. So I climb up the stairs, and there's Amanda, and she's sitting there with those puppy dog eyes, and she's just looking at me, and I don't know what she was waiting for, but, you know, it wasn't going to be good, and she's nervous, and I go in, and I begin, and I get down on my knee, and I just look her in the eye, and I remember this. She's about 11. And I just started talking to her about the importance of respect to her mother. And I began to reinforce the fact of why this was not allowable, and this was something we had to correct. And the more I talked about it, I started getting emotional. Next thing you know, there's tears rolling down my cheeks. I'm pretty sure Amanda was thinking, Dad, I think I'm the one that's supposed to be crying, not you. But I just felt moved at that moment. Like, I don't want to have to chasten you. I want you to just get this. And I saw a look in her eye, and we had one of those moments, and I don't believe I ever again, from that moment on, had to do any kind of correction other than just my words and my voice. You know why? She sensed that her actions broke her daddy's heart. And also the impact it had on her mommy. In other words, it went to her heart of love and care for her father. So Jesus, in his writings, is appealing to you and I, the one who paid the price for our eternal life. He says, just stay. Stay in the straight and narrow. Stay in the path. I don't want to have to come and correct. I will because I love you. Because only correcting will correct the course. Only bringing it in will correct the course. I love this one quote by Ravi Zacharias, an author and a Christian apologist. He said these words. He said, sin will take us farther than we want to go, keep us longer than we want to stay, and cost us more than we ever wanted to pay. And so God tonight, and God continually says, I will correct because I want to keep you on the right path and keep you from those places that are going to cost you dearly and are not part of my plan. It is an expression of that love that motivated the letter. Let me keep going here. Jesus said in Matthew 16:18, I will build my church. Jesus said, I will build my church. Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail or be successful against it. So I believe the third and final motivation is Jesus wants to keep his church, you and I, strong. Wants to keep us strong. So we don't fall for every deceiving voice. So we don't continually trip up and go into those areas that are going to cost us. I want to keep my church strong. I believe that's the heart of Christ tonight. Listen. Verse by verse. Week by week. Message upon message. If this is your church here, if not somewhere else, will you go? But all of this, Jesus is using to build his church. And I may want to add it this way. Verse by verse, week by week, message upon message, Jesus is still building his church. It wasn't just the book of Acts in that first century. It is still to this night. The motivation for these letters is, let's expose the wrong, let's look at it, let's be honest, let's deal with it, and let's get strong again. Why? Why is that so important? Because a weak church has little impact on the society around it. A church that is in chaos, a church that is unstable, a church that has allowed all kinds of conflict to come in. Listen, why do you think Satan fights so hard against our unity? Why do you think he's putting thoughts in some heads that like challenge things that are just out in left field? Why did he allow that woman to have such a seducing influence? Because he is out to weaken you and I. Jesus Christ's expression to this world around us is the church. If we're weak, if we're imbalanced, if we're irrelevant because we're fighting among ourselves, we will never impact the world out there. Amanda sent out an email a couple weeks ago, and she asked all any of you that would be interested to send back a message of a testimony of what the Haven Church means to you or what God has done in your life, a testimony. And I have been weeping over the responses for weeks, hearing how God has used this church, not me, us, to change people's lives. How? Because we love them. Because we tell them you're welcome in God's presence. Because we tell them we're not going to judge you by everything else everybody else judge you by. You got a clean slate here, and God is the judge, by the way. And because we create an atmosphere of joy and a little bit of deep breath, it's what we need, and it's what you have helped express, and it is changing people's lives. That is the impact we're supposed to have. And that's why Satan is always trying to bring division. That's why he is always trying to get us to have little petty things that come up. Listen, can I just challenge you? This is a wonderful group of people, and we are a no-drama zone. We deal with drama here, and thank God it has been virtually drama-free. But can I just tell you, let's not be critical. Can I ask you, don't be petty. Would you look at your neighbor and say, don't be petty. Don't be petty. Not that petty. Not that petty. Don't be petty. Let the little things slide. God takes care of the heart. God takes care. God deals with. It's the Holy Spirit's job to convict. It's not even my job to convict. I just bring the message. You just love one another, and we let him do his job with others like we want him to do with ourselves. Jesus said, I'm wrapping this up now. Jesus said in Matthew 5, he said, you are the light of the world. You, he's talking to the church. You say, I thought Jesus was the light. Well, Jesus is in you. So he said, you're the light. You're like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds, your godly love for one another, shine. Ooh, let it shine. For all to see that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. You see what he does at the end? Ultimately, if we shine, you know who they see? They see the Father. They're drawn to his heart. Whose heart? The heart of God that's compassionate and mercy. Continually, though we fail, he continually is compassionate. That's the heart we want all to get close to. The only way we do it, church, and the motive for Jesus sending the letter to any of these churches, no matter what the issue was to get it right so they could continue to shine God's love. That is our challenge tonight, too. Listen, the church is the expression of God's love to this world. We're to reflect the light of Jesus himself. How else is this world going to understand compassion if not from us? How else are they going to understand grace if not from you and I? Jesus says, I had to leave this world, but I'm leaving my Holy Spirit with you, and now you're my representatives, and oh, by the way, you're a light which is shine brightly. People will be drawn, and then they will give God the glory. Let me end with this illustration. Everybody get out their phones for a minute, would you? Get out your phones, please. Everybody get out their phone. Now, if you have a flashlight app, if you have a flashlight on your phone, I want you to just put that on and just hold on to it for a minute. Let me have yours for a minute. If you have a flashlight on your phone, just hold on to it a minute. Now, I want to illustrate something. I used to love that TV show Mission Impossible. And I love the movies, the series of the movies. And after all the bad stuff is revealed, some voice comes on, and he says to the main guy, he said, your mission is impossible. No. What? Good try. What is it? Wasn't even close. What is it? Your mission.
Should you choose to accept it?
Should you choose to accept it? I know that was difficult. It was really painful, but we made it through. I thought it was going to be easier. It's okay. It's all right. It's okay. I scare the front row sometimes. You know, that's why these are rare seats, but I appreciate it. You got to be really tough to sit on the front row. Here's the deal. Jesus said, you're the light. You're the expression of my love to this world. So, church, I want to tell you tonight, based on these words that we have looked at and studied, your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to leave this place and to shine bright. Hold up those phones. Brandon, would you kill those lights? It's not dark in here at all, is it? It's not dark in here at all. This is wonderful. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, when you leave this place and all this week, is just shine. Shine your light. Be love. Be the smile. I'm telling you, it seems like it's so daunting, but look at this place. It's lit up. Why? Because you're not alone. You're not alone. You're part of a community. Thanks, Brandon. You're part of a community. You're part of light. Stand tonight. I want to pray a prayer blessing over you guys that when we leave this place, we will be inspired through the love and the compassion of Jesus to keep building his church, and that you and I will shine his love. Bow your heads. Let me pray with you. Father, I thank you. I thank you for these moments. I thank you for your word. I thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit. And now I am praying for each one in this place. Inspire them as individuals and us as a community to shine bright this week. That people will be drawn to your heart, to your love. They will see something in us, and that something is you. And they'll be drawn to the heart of the Father. I pray a blessing over each home and each family represented. I ask, bless our time of fellowship in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I love you guys. Come on, leave this place and shine, would you? Somebody shine.